Now we have our animation,
we're going to want to turn it into frames and then video on our computer. First though, we need to set up some important render and output settings. Also, if you're not caught up with the course, make sure to follow the videos if you want to follow along. Otherwise, you can just follow along with your own project. I'm going to start off by coming to my render output set. This looks like the back of a camera, and this is where we can actually tell Blender certain factors such as the quality to render at, and of course the speed as well. At the top here, you can choose your render engine. Eevee will be much faster, but it will also be a much lower quality. Notice how with metals here, Eevee really struggles. Sometimes though, if you're using non-metal materials and non-glass materials, Eevee can look quite good. But I find Eevee works best with more toon styles, such as this anime shader here. I'm going to change back to cycles. Here under device, you can choose to use your GPU if you would like. This can allow for faster render, although unfortunately the GPU on my computer isn't compatible with Blender, which is why I use CPU. If you want to be able to enable your GPU for faster rendering in Blender, you can first left click edit and then choose preferences. Then if you left click system here, you can see at the top there's cycles renders devices, which is just pretty much choosing the graphics card you want to use. You can choose whichever option here works best with your graphics card. It can be helpful to read what it says here, as you can notice here there's no compatible ones for my computer. Since there's so many types of graphics cards, I recommend doing a little bit of research into it yourself to find out the best option for your specific graphics card. For now, I'm going to change it back to none since I'll just use my processor or CPU. Once you've made any changes, you can also left click these three bars here and choose save preferences for good measure. When you're done with that, you can go ahead and just close the preferences menu. Here we have the sampling, and sampling is essentially a number that determines the amount of calculations Blender performs to create our rendered result. It'll take in factors such as the materials, the lighting, and the geometry of the object itself in order to calculate how our image will look. So as you might imagine, more calculations or more samples will mean a better quality image, but more calculations also means a longer wait time for rendering. That's why finding a good balance is key. Here under viewport, this will determine what our image looks like when we use this button here called the viewport shading render preview, which allows us to preview what our rendered image will look like, but it's not the same as the final result. And for that reason, I will set it to a lower number. Here I've set it to something as low as 10, which will make a really grainy image, but because I'm recording here and I need a fast computer, 10 will suffice for me. The important settings we need to worry about here are these render ones. You can see here the default is 4096 samples, which is a lot of samples, especially if you're doing an animation. I wouldn't even use this amount for a single image. We also have this option called denoise, which is a great way to get rid of some of the grainy effects after the render is complete. I pretty much always have this enabled. There's also the noise threshold here, which will allow Blender to speed through rendering a lot easier, taking the noise of the image into consideration. For a faster render, increasing this number here will make render faster, but also it can look lower quality if you put it up too high. Now I've explained what some of these settings do. Another setting here to be aware of are these light paths here. We're going to keep these at the default for this project, but these can have an effect on render time too, especially if they're set really high. You can see you've got some presets here as well. For example, full global illumination looks really great, but it also takes a lot more time as it sets all these to a much higher number. Another way to speed up lighting is to change the clamping here. I like to change this direct light value here to 5. Caustics are a feature you sometimes use with glass or transparent materials. They can considerably increase render times, but they do look pretty amazing when done well. So that's something to keep in mind for future projects. Under color management here, we can make tweaks to our render without having to change the lights or the materials. A look that I found worked well for this project was to change the look from none to medium high contrast. That will create a bit more contrast, which will help the subject of the image here stand out more. If you set this value too high to something like very high contrast, you can see the effect now looks a little bit too strong. The same applies if you make this a bit too low. Now the image looks a lot more flat and desaturated. I found medium high contrast was a good pick for this, but sometimes you might even want to go for high contrast, or you might want to leave it at default. I'm going to come back up to my render settings here, and before I change my samples, I'm going to first create some output settings. To do that, you come to this output properties here. And since this looks like a printer, you could remember it as the thing that comes out of the printer is the output. So it's the output settings. At the top here, we have our resolution of our image. I'm keeping it at 2K. Then we have our frame rate, which I have set to 30 frames per second. That means for every 30 frames, 1 second will pass. And then finally, we have our output here. Here, you can just press this folder button and choose a location on your computer to save all the frames. I recommend creating a brand new folder and then saving it there. So I'll left click this button. And now if I want to add a folder to save my frames in, I can just press this plus folder button, and maybe I'll call this animation frames, but you can call it anything you like. Then I'll just double click it and then press accept. Now you can see that our output has been set to that folder. If you're only rendering a single image, you don't actually need to create an output folder. So first, I'm going to go over what I would typically do for rendering a single image. Since it's only one image, I can have a bit of a higher sample count than I would for an animation. And typically, I find a sample count of 200 is enough for me. But you could even go for something like 500 or even 1000 if you really want to. I'll also keep my noise threshold at 0.01. Then when you're ready, you can first press File and then choose Save, just in case Blender crashes. And then you can press Render and then choose Render Image to render the current frame. Another thing I'll do is change to the solid view. That way my computer won't be doing as much processing, which will make our render faster. Then you can go ahead and press Render and then choose Render Image to render the current frame. Now you'll see a new window has come up, and this is the Blender render window. You can see my one's finished already, but it will start calculating the samples, and then when it's finished, you won't see any more sample changes. And it should look something like this, such as a finished time. I set mine to a super low sample count, just so I could quickly show this to you, as yours will probably take a bit longer. Then, once you're ready, you can left-click this image button, and then choose Save As, and then you can choose a location on your computer to save it. For now, I'm gonna press this X button to close out of this menu. Now, for final animation, I'd probably want to make my max sample something like 100, or maybe even 50. As you saw there, the sample I used for that single image was only 5 samples, which shows you can still get away with a really low sample count. So take that into consideration, as rendering loads of images can take a lot of time. For now, I'll leave my max samples on 100, as that's what I used for this project animation. And I'm going to change my noise threshold to 0.05. This will speed up my render as well. Also, if you were wondering what this minimum samples was, this would stop the noise threshold from stopping the samples at a certain point. But for us, we're not going to worry about that. Also, make sure your time limit here is set to 0. If you have it set to anything higher, your render will just stop after a certain point, and that might be undesirable. 0 will make it so it takes as long as it needs to take. Once I've done that, I'm going to make sure my timeline is all set up. So I'm going to change from Shader Editor here to Timeline. And just as I'm wanting, I've got my start frame at 1 and end frame at 250. So once you're happy with that, you can go ahead and press Render and choose Render Animation. Once you do that, the Render menu will pop up again, and it will start rendering through each frame, and all those frames will appear in this output folder that you set earlier. Here's roughly what it will look like when you have all your frames in one place when the animation is finished. You can see that all the frames are numbered, and you can also view these as images by pressing this button here, or you can view them as a list by pressing this button here. But something you may have been wondering is, why did we actually render these as frames and not just straight into a video? The reason for that is because if Blender crashes halfway through the render, we could potentially lose the entire video file. Whereas if you render it as images and it crashes, the previous rendered images won't just disappear, and you can resume rendering the animation when you open Blender again. Of course though, we're going to want to turn all our frames into a video. So if you want to skip the next animation project and jump straight into turning your frames into a video, you can check out episode 9 of this course on the top right hand corner. Keep in mind, if you're watching this while this video airs, the episode won't be out for another 3 days. But in the meantime, you can watch this older video of mine where I pretty much teach the same thing. For now though, we're going to have a quick quiz to recap what we learned today. Number 1, how can we make our render pop more without tweaking the lighting or materials? Number 2, why is it best to render our animations as images or frames rather than video? Number 3, what 2 settings did we change to improve our render time? Feel free to pause the video and take your time to answer the questions. Then when you're ready, you can press play and then I'll answer the questions for you. Number 1, how can we make our render pop more without tweaking the lighting or materials? To do this, we came to our render properties. Then if we scroll down to the bottom, there's this tab called color management. Here we could change the look of our image to increase the contrast. The good thing about contrast is it helps bring your viewer's attention to the image. So that's why it can be helpful to increase the contrast. Just make sure not to go overboard with this, otherwise it might look a bit weird. Number 2, why is it best to render our animations as images rather than video? This is more of a just in case Blender crashes during rendering. If we do it as video, we might lose the entire video file. Whereas if we do it as images, we can just resume rendering at the point in which Blender crashed, and we won't lose any of our work. And then once we have our finished images, we can just turn them into a video using Blender's sequencer, which we will cover in episode 9 of this course. Number 3, what 2 settings did we change to improve render time? In our render properties settings here, we changed under render, as this will control how our image looks in the final render. We could first increase our noise threshold in order to speed up the render, and also making sure we don't have a crazy high max samples will also help us have a faster render. This is important as the default for this is around 4096, which is a ridiculously high amount of calculations, and you're going to be sitting there for a while, especially if you're doing an animation. For my animation, I went for a sample count of 100 and a noise threshold of 0.05, but you can do something even quicker if you would like. Great job on completing the quiz. If you're unsure if you got any of the questions right, feel free to write them in the comment section below, and I'll happily answer them for you. You can also let me know if you have any other questions about today's lesson, and I'll do my best to answer it for you. In the next lesson, we're going to be starting our second project in this course. This project will be a lot quicker since we've already covered most of the things that we'll need. And to start off, we'll be making these hexagon shapes using the Tissue built-in Blender add-on again. Also, if you enjoy my teaching style, I also provide one-on-one coaching, completed with personalized lessons and post-lesson quiz questions and support. Link in the description if you're interested. Thank you for making it to the end of the video. You can also support the channel by making a one-time donation through Super, but even just liking, subscribing, and sharing if you enjoyed is more than enough to support the channel. Thank you again for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Take care.